I'm not English, but it's a British passport. So I hold actually the passport of our older occupiers. This grants me a particular immunity, if I may say so, to say something completely independent. Ladies and gentlemen, if you perhaps just read the news, you would definitely discover that India, a leader of this conference, is Israel's biggest importer of weapons. Furthermore, Nigeria, the biggest supposedly Islamic or not Islamic country in Africa, abstained in the vote for a Palestinian state last December in the UN. So, if these are the basic elements or the point of departure of our question, which is what is needed from Asian African countries, then we are facing a little bit of an uphill. However, I know that one needs not to be a Palestinian in order to express his solidarity in this way or another with the Palestinians, for it's neither human nor humane to think that you cannot be subjective. Ladies and gentlemen, we had a session about gender earlier. I'm not sure whether I was focused enough, but I'd like to borrow a sentence from a leading feminist in 1970, Carol Hayes, who said, "The personal is political." And we cannot practically detach ourselves, whether we are Palestinians, Africans, Asians, Latin Americans, from a miscarriage of justice that has been going on for 67 years. And it's been going on because the media have not been telling the overwhelming majority of the world what is happening on the ground in Palestine. And it's in particular because the Jewish and the Israel lobby started already in 1917 and earlier, even actually in Basel in 1897, to set the format for this combination between money or finance and the media. I'm not actually blaming them, and in fact you will not hear me saying anything wrong, neither against the Jews nor against Israel. I can only blame us and our friends for anything that we are not doing similar to what they are doing, and probably something that we should do or be doing better, especially in media. Every time there is any violence in Palestine, and let's just underline the term violence. What is violence? This is resistance. Whether we agree with this form or another, there are people under occupation trying to resist, peacefully or unpeacefully, to seek and implement and have freedom, liberation, and independence. What is wrong about that? Whereas you, in fact, plural, if we follow the media, mainstream media in the world, we will find that the flow of information which comes from the north to south is completely biased and controlled by Israel's Zionist lobby. Now, information, ladies and gentlemen, is available, and I'm not going to act here as a news agency at all, but the task is, how do we join the dots and come with an organized plan? And this is exactly what I'm going to suggest, Dr. Darwish, to this conference. I am a scholar, but I'm Palestinian. I'm a peace activist, but I'm an internationalist. I fought and struggled for South Africa when I was a student in Oxford, and I was fighting as I were black African. And I expect every black African or yellow Asian to fight with me as Palestinian the way I fought with them when they had their fight. So what I'm asking actually will probably have something to do with the French sociologist Pierre Bourdieu's paradigm. He spoke about four types of power: economic, political, military, and cultural. And when he spoke about the cultural, he made a particular point and emphasized the symbolic culture. And the symbolic culture or power or capital is exactly, by and large, the way the world or the media frame our conflict in every possible language. Unfortunately, even in Britain, the mother of our plight, we Palestinians, even in Britain, there was a survey amongst young British who thought that Palestine is occupying Israel and not Israel is occupying Palestine. And this is thanks, in brackets, in a very ironical manner, to the fact that even the BBC, which I personally as well contribute to its public funding, even the BBC refused in 2009 to broadcast the appeal when Israel waged a war against the Palestinians. It was an appeal, a very charitable humanitarian appeal to help those affected in Gaza. Now, what I'm suggesting, in fact, is an answer to this question, what is needed from Asian African countries. I actually, if I may so, and in German, suggest the following. What can the African, Asian, Latin American do for Palestine? I'm going to suggest something that will make me ask you, what can Palestine do for you? And Palestine can do for you if we go back and stick to the Bandung spirits and principles. Because if we establish, and please kindly pay attention to the following sentence, if we establish a research-led lobby, I repeat, a research-led lobby, an international, transnational, cross boundaries, whatever you call it, the Bandung Conference will be helped by Palestine, and Palestine will be helped by the Bandung Conference. And I am talking about a very sophisticated lobby, and I don't want to mention now what lobbies control or are powerful entities in the world. Least to mention would be Israel's lobby. Lobby is not anymore a bad word, ladies and gentlemen. You know, excellencies, you know that this is the way to operate. When you combine, like the talk that our colleague from the university here suggested, when we combine research with plans, with activism, then we can probably launch and defend the spirits of Bandung, the Asian, African, Latin American partnership, and serve the Palestinian cause as a main cause which should be carried on the hands and in the brains of every peaceful person on earth. And what I'm suggesting, in fact, and I do very much applaud and very much have strong respect and admiration to the initiators of this conference, because I see it, and given the fact that this is a multidisciplinary and interdisciplinary conference, I see it as a brainstorming for something that can happen in the future. This is exactly a research method tool, a brainstorming, a focus group, a survey to hear all these opinions and to forge a network. But what I am saying is that it may well be that the Bandung spirits and the conference needs, or they need, rebranding, managing reputation, deciding on an image. And I saw a lot of contents, especially yesterday, from several interventions here that actually can serve Bandung and Palestine. They can serve Bandung and Palestine because I'm asking you kindly to express your solidarity by supporting us through symbolic culture, through symbolic power, through the media, and through cultural academic activities. Because we know that media are being fed by a lot of advisors who study at universities. And if they study the full picture and they have a panoramic view at the university, they study about Bandung and its spirits and about Palestine, that this is still the most pressing remaining issue since 1948, it will definitely give us an international intervention via a lobby which can work and incorporate all or many universities or all groups and NGOs, but it will be in fact run and managed according to the Bandung spirits and principles. And I'm talking actually about a proper organization, again, which should be, in my opinion, be research-led, lobby according to the Bandung spirits and principles. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Guru. We will have the floor for 5 minutes, and then we have 3 or 4 minutes for...
Sure. What I'd like to say is that information or disinformation have never parted the minds of policymakers in Israel. They see actually media warfare, disinformation and propaganda as part of war, and clearly you must have heard as well about the embedded journalists, and this was actually a long tactic and an old tactic ran by Israel before the Americans used it in the 2003 war in Iraq. What I'm saying, Your Excellency, is yes, we have to be optimistic, but the source of optimism should be our struggle, our constant struggle, but this shouldn't make us forget that it's been 67 years, we don't know how many more years where the story is going to last, and the occupation is going to last. I emphasize here that Palestine is a long-term cause. Even if there will be a state at some point, it's a long-term cause for our partnership here. And therefore, what tells us Gramsci, actually, in his memoir from prison, he says that this is a counter-hegemonic project. It's a project which should be one and re-won, a project which we should work in order to counter the oppressive dominant power of the occupier, so that we are actually ready at every twist and turn to continue to counter him or them until they actually fail. And this is why I'm kindly requesting the establishment in this way or another, whether it's part of a whole lobby which would serve the whole Bandung conference, or a lobby which will have a campaign for Palestine, this international constellation, so that Palestine will remain the soul of the spirits of the Bandung conference.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you for a very good question, Mr. Manager of the museum here. I think in order to make my idea or suggestion, which is turning either the Bandung conference into a pressure group with Palestine as part of it or for Palestine, it doesn't matter. This needs a business plan. And this business plan should have a strategy and should have a marketing strategy and should have an events management and media relations. We're talking here about really deconstructing my idea, because I haven't actually thrown this idea out of the blue. I have been thinking about it for 3 years. In fact, initially I thought about the establishment, and I will be doing that, the establishment for the first time ever of the Lobby for Palestine internationally. And this lobby will be forging relations with any international, national, regional NGO or cultural, academic, media body that can be really forged with. So in fact, in order to make this idea operational, we need a business plan. I've got part of it. I definitely, if we would like to collaborate with the Bandung conference, there should be talks, mutual bilateral talks, where we can discuss this. And I'd be more than happy that Indonesia in particular could host something like that, or other countries. But definitely, this idea can be a grand project where it can serve the the spirits of the Verdun Conference on the one hand, and it can have a return, because then the very raison d'etre of the Verdun Conference will be absolutely implemented, and on the other hand, the Palestinians will definitely be served properly, and it will be a cause for liberation, equality, and freedom. So there will be operational, practical steps that should be taken. Now, when it comes to the very bold question from Dr. Darwish about do we or do we not, should I stay or should I go? Well, I think that there is no point in establishing diplomatic ties with Israel if you don't have ties. And if you have ties, it's about time to use them in order to get to curb Israel's military occupation. So whichever is the case, it's always better not to please the thief and give him a price for his robbery. As for the other question, madam, about the balance or imbalance, well, to be honest, as we heard, Israel wasn't invited to the Verdun Conference, and it wasn't invited for a reason. And secondly, with all due respect, I didn't hear you commenting the same way that in the gender session they should have, we should have had another session by men, for example. So I think that there is a common sense of justice that should be prevailed. We are talking here about an occupation. We are not indulging and entertaining ourselves with Israeli pop here. We are talking about an occupation which is stifling the lives of millions of Palestinians on a daily basis. And interestingly enough, you are talking to someone whose family and myself have been living in the part of Palestine that was occupied in 1948. Palestine was occupied in two steps, 48 and 67. And I come from Jaffa, and I have been living under the first Israeli occupation ever since, and I master Hebrew, and I assure you that what we are doing is very much acceptable on many intellectual Jews and Israelis. And if you follow the research, the fresh research by new historians, you will find out that the overwhelming majority of anti-Zionist and anti-Israel's stances have been written by Israeli Jewish scholars against the policies of Israel and against the ethnic cleansing that Israel has been conducting in historical Palestine. Thank you.
Thank you very much.